Hello friends, welcome to the session on HDFS architecture. So before this, I hope you know that Hadoop has three core components in the second version of Hadoop. And these three components are HDFS for distributed storage, MapReduce for distributed processing, and YARN for resource management, right? And now we will be digging down deep into each of the components separately. And that's where we have picked HDFS for now. So we'll be talking more on HDFS in this particular session. So now you remember that we have talked about that a system can be designed in two ways, monolithic and distributed. However, all the good big data systems are based on a distributed architecture just to make it scalable. We have covered this in the previous session, right? So we will be always talking about a distributed system throughout our course. And HDFS is also made of a distributed system. You can see that I have showcased a four node cluster, right? So you remember a cluster is made of nodes. A node is nothing but one server, right? So consider we have a four node HDFS cluster, right? This together is called as a cluster. Now we can have 1000 nodes also, but in this case we have four nodes, as simple as that. Now consider you have a four node cluster and you have a very big file with some content. For our simplicity and ease of calculations, let us consider that this file is 500 MB. Ideally 500 MB is not huge data, but consider or think that I am contradicting myself by saying the file is very big, but 500 MB. The number 500 MB came just to ease out our calculations. So you have a very big file of 500 MB and you have a four node cluster. Now, on which node do you want to store this file? Is it okay if I give this entire file on node 1? Just think of it. No, it is not okay. First of all, when I'm saying it is very big, then probably there is a chance that this file might be bigger than this machine's disk size. That means it might not fit properly in this machine at all. Or even if it fits, then also it is not the right choice, because we have other machines which we are wasting, or we are not utilizing our resources wisely if we are giving this entire big file to just one machine. It is same as monolithic. If we are giving this one file to just one machine, then what is the need of having these other three machines? So this is not a good thing that you give one file to one machine. Even if it is possible, you should not do that. So the correct way would be that if you have four machines, then ideally or logically, if you think, then you might feel that, is there a way we can divide it into four parts? Right? Is there a way we can divide this file into four parts and give each part to a separate machine or separate node? So you can say this. And whenever I use the word parts, parts is a very raw term. The technical word used here is called as a block, right? So you can see this 500 MB file, we have divided into four blocks, and each block is stored on a different node as shown in the diagram. You can have a look. Now this is a better choice than the previous choice, because in the previous choice, we were storing the entire file on one machine and wasting the other three resources. In this case, we are trying to leverage, in the current scenario, we are trying to leverage all the resources wisely. And our file will be broken down into blocks, and these blocks are stored across the nodes on the cluster. So if I have to say that a 500 MB file is divided into four blocks, and each block is stored on a separate node in the four node cluster. Now, how do we came to a conclusion that we have to divide this into four blocks? Some of you might be tempted to feel that it is just because we have four nodes, so we divide it into four blocks. No, it is not the case. The block or the number of blocks is dependent on the block size. And let me tell you, the block size in Hadoop 1 was 64 MB, and the block size in Hadoop 2, which we use currently, because Hadoop 2 is the current version of Hadoop which is used in industry, it is 128 MB. So the block size in Hadoop 2 is 128 MB. That means a file will be divided into blocks where each block will be of the size 128 MB. Right? So for example, when you consider this case, so you see the first block will be of 128 MB, the second will be of 128 MB, third one 128 MB, and of course the fourth one might be a little lesser. It is 116 MB. Now you might feel that what about 12 MB? Is it wasted? No, it will free up the space. So we do not have to worry about it, but it won't waste the remaining 12 MB. It will free it up. So you can see a 500 MB file is divided into four blocks, where each block ideally is of 128 MB, with the exception of the last block, which might be a little bit lesser. You can clearly see this diagram. It should give you a very good understanding. So we have stored this file across the machines on the cluster. Tomorrow you want to read this file one from this cluster. How do you know what is kept where? This currently I am showing you, you know block one is there, block two is there, block three is there, block four is here. But tomorrow if you want to come back and read this file from this cluster, how do you know what is where? It becomes really hard. And that is why we need to have someone who tracks what is kept where. Because it is not that we send something somewhere, no. But someone has to track what is kept where. And that is where we have a master node. And all these nodes are slaves. The master node is there to track what is kept where. Probably when I go to the next diagram, it will be very much clear. And by the way, you have to remember one very important thing. The master node is called as the name node. And all the slaves are called as the data nodes. I will tell you why these are called data nodes and why this is called as the name node. You will understand this shortly. But remember or make a note of this thing. The master is called as the name node, which stores the metadata on what is kept where. And all the nodes where data is stored is called as the data nodes, the slaves basically. So it is a master slave architecture where master is nothing but the name node and the slaves is nothing but the data node. The data nodes hold the actual data in the form of blocks, because you see block one, it is actual content, right? This particular thing. Block two is nothing but this particular thing. So you can very clearly see the data node holds the actual data in the form of blocks. And the name node holds the name or namespace information or the metadata mentioning what is kept where. This diagram will clearly demonstrate that. So you can see in this we have a name node, and name node has or is holding the namespace information of what is kept where. For example, it is saying file one has block one, and it is stored on data node 1, DN1. File 1, the block 2 is stored on data node 2, right here. File 1, block 3, data node 3, as here. File 1, block 4, data node 4, here. This is the kind of table which name node will hold in memory. And why it is holding in memory? So that it can retrieve this information very, very quickly. Because if it is on disk, the access time is not that high. That is why this table is kept in memory of the name node, so that after checking this table, it can quickly tell what is kept where if it is required. So what does the name node hold? Name node holds the metadata in the form of table, which keeps a track of what is kept where. And data node holds the actual data in the form of blocks. That's why it is called as data. So for example, if you are someone sitting on a computer and you make a request that I want to find or I want to read file 1. So think client node is nothing but you sitting on a laptop and you made a request for reading file 1. Where will your request go? Will your request go to the name node or will your request go to the data? Since you do not know where is this file kept, your request will always go to the name node, because name node holds the complete information on what is kept. So your request goes to the name node, and name node will check its table or metadata table to see where exactly file 1 is kept. So So it sees this table and gets the information that, okay, block one is on data node one, block two is on data node two, all this information. So name node will give you this information back. You can check this out, right? The name node will tell you, okay, since you want to read file one, let me tell you file one is kept at this all location. Right? You can see very clearly. Now, once you get this information, the client will kind of read the data from whatever the addresses are mentioned in this metadata information. That means first the process was that client wants to read the request, goes to the name node. Name node will check the table and respond back to the client saying, okay, go ahead and read it from these all places. Then the client will basically read it from those places, whatever are mentioned in the response. You can see this in the diagram very clearly. But the role of name node is just maintaining the metadata table and mentioning that, okay, it is stored here. Name node is not going to read the file on our behalf. It is we only that we are reading the file. You can see the client node is only requesting from the data nodes once it gets the information. Just have a look at this diagram. So let me repeat the cycle again. So let's say client node is nothing but we sitting on a particular laptop and requesting that I want to read file. The request goes to the name node because name node has the complete information on what is kept. Name node internally checks its table, metadata table, and tells you, okay, go ahead and read the file from these all places, data node 1, 2, 3, and 4. Then the client node will go and read the data from those all places. Now, this is all background process. You do not have to worry, but this is how internally it works, right? So this is how a basically cluster looks like, a name node and multiple data nodes. This is like a four node cluster in this case. Now we need to talk about a scenario. First of all, before that, let me tell you one thing. Data nodes are made of commodity hardware. This means that these data nodes are cheap hardware just to make sure the cost of the cluster is low, right? So data nodes can go down anytime. It's not that the data nodes are highly reliable. No, data nodes can go down because it is made of commodity hardware. However, name nodes are made of high quality. You need to remember these two things. Data nodes are made of commodity hardware. That means this machine might go down very frequently. However, name nodes are made of high quality hardware. That means the failure of name node might not be that frequent, but still this can also fail. I'm not saying that name node cannot fail. Name node can also fail, but chances are very less. However, data node can fail very frequently as data node is made of cheap hardware, just to make sure the cost of cluster is low, right? So now we need to talk about two scenarios. The first scenario is, what if a data node fails? How to tackle that? And second is, what if a name node fails? You remember, name node is made of high quality hardware, but still chances are there it can fail. So we need to talk about the failure management of data node and failure management of name node. So first, let us talk about what if a data node fails. And this is quite simple. Now consider, this is how four blocks are kept on four different nodes. Now, if let's say this data node one goes down, don't you feel this block one is lost? And then there is a data loss just because of this. But data losses are not tolerable in production environments. Then how to make sure if a data node fails, nothing is lost? For this, Hadoop has come with a strategy that there will be a replication factor. And the default replication factor in Hadoop is 3. That means each block has 3 copies. That means if block 1 is there, block 1 will have another 2 copies. That means totally there will be 3 copies. There is nothing like one original and 2 duplicates. All 3 copies will be treated the same. Now consider that all the 3 copies, if they are kept on same data node, then also it won't help, because if this data node goes down, then all the 3 copies are gone. So this also indicates that the copy should not be kept on the same machine. Because if all the same copies or all the replicas are kept on same machine, then also it will incur to database. A problem is not solved. And remember, in Hadoop, the default replication factor is 3. This can be tuned by the Hadoop admins. We do not have to worry. They can make it 2 if the application is not sensitive. They can even make it 1 if you are working on a proof of concept. That means if data is lost, let it be lost. They can even make it 5 if they feel the data is so critical. It depends on them. However, as per the default settings, it is 3 and it works in most of the cases very well. As I said, holding all the replicas on the same machine does not make sense, because if this machine goes down again, our data is lost. It does not serve our purpose. That means the replicas should be kept on different machines. You see, B1 is here, B1 is here, and B1 is here. 3 replicas are there, kept on 3 different machines. And this makes perfect sense, because if this machine goes down, then other 2 blocks or other 2 copies are also there on different machines, and we can retrieve. Now you can see very clearly that your name node metadata should also hold the information about the replicas. So you can see file 1, block 1, and if it is kept on block 1 is kept on data node 1, data node 2, and data node 4. So it is mentioned here: data node 1, data node 2, data node 4. File 1, block 2, data node 2, data node 3, data node 4. That means your name node table or the metadata table should be up to date, and it should hold the lines or the entries for the replications also. Because if this fails, then this should know where are the other replicas kept, right? So you should have the entries for all the 3 replicas in this metadata table, so that if one machine fails, then name node knows where are the other 2 copies kept. You can just have a look at this diagram for a clear understanding, right? So this is how it is. And we can change the replication factor as per our requirement. However, having said that, for the developer, we will never change it. Our administrators or Hadoop administrators will change it, and we do not have to worry on that part. Now the question comes, how do the name node know whether data node has failed? I mean, we said it failed, but how will the name node get to know? For this, there is the concept of heartbeat mechanism, right? So make a note of it. It is a very important thing that each data node sends the heartbeat to the name node every 3 seconds by default. Each data node sends the heartbeat to the name node every 3 seconds by default, indicating or signaling that it is alive. Consider this heartbeat like a signal saying I am alive. And if the name node does not get the heartbeat for 10 consecutive cycles or 10 consecutive times, that means if the name node does not receive the heartbeat from a data node for 30 seconds, then the name node will assume that the data node either is dead or very, very slow. Right? So just read it here. Each data node sends heartbeat to name node every 3 seconds. If a name node doesn't send heartbeat for 10 consecutive times, it assumes that data node is dead or running very slow and will mark it for deletion. When I say will mark it for deletion, I will mean that it has to remove the entry from this metadata table. Because when this is not there and name node understood that, okay, this is not sending heartbeat for 30 seconds, probably it is dead, then name node has to update this metadata table to remove this particular metadata entry. Now, don't you feel after this entry is removed, the replication factor for, let's say, data node 1 goes down and block 1 was stored. Now, don't you feel only 2 copies are left, block 1 and block 1? However, in our configuration, the default setting says we should have 3 copies. That means the number of copies came down to what was expected. That means if a data node goes down, the replication factor came to a number which is less than desired, which is less than 3. That means this is the critical situation. And in this case, your HDFS or the name node will make enough mechanisms to replicate this 3 or whatever block stored here to other machines. You can see this block 1, it will store again here one more copy. Block 3, it will store here, let's say, and block 4 here. You do not have to worry. Again, it will be done. The new copy created by the name node. Just to make sure, number of copies or the replicas still should be 3, even after the failure. The name node has done enough work in the background just to make sure if a data node fails, the under-replicated blocks are again replicated with one more copy so that the replication factor comes up to 3 again. And again, once it puts block 4, block 1, block 3 here, it will mention it in the metadata table so that the metadata table should be up to date. You can just have a look at this diagram. So you can see again these 3 new entries have been marked because metadata table should be the latest one. So this is how your name node gets to know that data node is failed based on the heartbeat mechanism. And once it gets to know it is failed, it will do enough mechanisms to replicate the under-replicated blocks. So with this, we have covered how to handle failure in case of a data node failure. So let us try to quickly recap what have we learned, and then we will do the other things in the next set of session. So let me quickly revise. So we initially talked that we are talking about a distributed system. That means we have multiple nodes, not just one machine. We are not talking about a monolithic system. So in this case, let's say we have a 4 node cluster. We can even have a 1000 node cluster, right? Now, if there is a file, it is not good that we just give it to one machine because it again becomes or mimics monolithic. Rather, it is better if we divide it into multiple blocks and give each block to a machine, as in this case, right? So in this case, we have 4 blocks and 4 machines. So this is the scenario. Now, let me give you a scenario. What if we have a 1 GB file? If we have a 1 GB file, then as per the default block size in Hadoop 2, we will have 8 blocks. Because 1 GB divided by 128 MB will lead to 8 blocks. And if we have 4 machines, that means in each machine, ideally, we will get 2 blocks. So might be block 1 and block 2 stored here. Block 2 and block 3 will be stored here. Block 3, block 4 will be here. Right? Block 1, block 2 here. Block 3, block 4. Block 5, block 6. And block 7, block 8. Like that. Right? So it depends. It's not that one node will hold one block only. One node can hold thousands of blocks because there are a lot of resources in each node, right? So we talked about that in Hadoop 1, the block size was 64 MB. In Hadoop 2, the block size is 128 MB, right? And this is how we said that data will be or blocks will be divided. And we have one master and multiple slaves. The master is nothing but the name node, which holds the metadata in the form of table like this. And the slaves are nothing but data nodes, which hold the data in the form of blocks. This is a 4 node cluster, which is shown. Now, let's say we are a client and we are sending a request. It goes to the name node. Name node checks the information in its table and will give you a response back, saying, okay, go ahead and read the data from these all places. Now, after that, the client node will go and read the data from those places. Right? Now, after that, we said, since it is made on commodity hardware, there can be chances that machines may fail. Data node failure has a high priority because data node is made of cheap hardware and name node is made of quality hardware. Still, when the name node is high quality hardware, it might fail. So we need to talk about two kind of failures, data node failure and name node failure. So initially we started with data node failure and we said to handle data node failure, we require replication factor. By default, replication factor is 3 in Hadoop, right? This can be tweaked by the administrators. And again, all the replicas should not be on the same machine because if the machine goes down, all the replicas are gone again. That's why it's better we should have replicas on different machines, as in this case. And again, all this replication information should also be contained in the metadata table. Now, how does the name node gets to know data node is read? Using the heartbeat mechanism, which we have covered. That each data node sends the heartbeat to name node every 3 seconds, indicating it is alive. And if it does not get heartbeat for 10 consecutive times, it will indicate that data node is dead. And then all this activity will take place, creating new copies, deleting the older metadata, and creating new metadata entries like this. So that we have the latest metadata information. So I will just stop this recording, and we'll talk about the future things like name node failure handling and all in the next session. So I'll stop the recording now. Thanks a lot, and I hope you enjoyed the session.